But you become the servant of who you respond to. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. You become the servant of who you surrender to. Amen. Praise God. I'll take you back to the kingdom. In the kingdom of God, things work differently. In the kingdom of God, it's not around the self. In the kingdom of this world, you know, our blessedness is in our position. It's in our power. It's in the wealth, you know, the comfort and the safety that we have. But in the kingdom of God, it's the exact opposite. Our blessedness is in the assurance of ultimate comfort and reward and intimacy with eternity in Jesus. Hallelujah. They are telling you, there's even so many Christians who have no glimpse of eternity. They don't even think about heaven. Hallelujah. They go about their daily affairs without even thinking about heaven. All they want is, you know, how much power, how much wealth, how much I can accumulate in this world. But I've got news for you. In the twinkling of an eye, all those things will pass away. It will matter no more. And only one thing will matter, and that's your intimacy with Jesus. What did he do for the kingdom of God? That's what will matter. Hallelujah. You see, in the kingdom of this world, our purpose in life is to enhance and advance ourselves in terms of personal peace and prosperity. But in the kingdom of God, it's the opposite. Our purpose in life is to advance the cause of our King. To advance the kingdom of our King by functioning as flavors and preservatives and by being light in this dark world. Hallelujah. Praise God. When we have a king, we have a subject. Amen. The subject has only one purpose: to defend, to protect the territory of the king. Hallelujah. And the king has got his own purpose: to defend, to protect, to provide for, to make sure there is peace, there is stability, and the total welfare of his kingdom. That's what the king cares about. But for the subject, your ultimate loyalty is to the king. Hallelujah. Amen. That's why I gave the people this illustration. When the first settlers came to Australia, all they did was to have the flag. And when they took the flag, they raised the flag on the ground and say, "I now reclaim this land for the crown." That's it. They did not reclaim it for themselves. They did not claim the land for themselves because they were sent. They were sent by the higher authority, by the king. And when they came, that's exactly what they did. But for Christians today, we all know that we are all ambassadors in this place. We're not here with our own agenda. But I want you to think and actually see, whose agenda are you pursuing? Hallelujah. Whose life are we living? What are the things that motivate you? What are the things that keep you going? Hallelujah. In the kingdom of this world, relationships are used for personal benefits. But in the kingdom of God, as I said, it's the opposite. Relationships are to remain pure, blameless, fair to the weak, and forgiving to the enemies. Hallelujah. Have you ever heard the saying, "Nothing goes for nothing"? Yeah, nothing goes for nothing. That means, you know, for me too, there's no free lunch. Yeah, that's the kingdom of this world. But in the kingdom of our God, it is different. Hallelujah. The practice of self-discipline is for you to surrender yourself under the lordship of the Lord Jesus. And let the word of God be the final authority in your life. And as I said before, it's sad to say that for so many believers, the word of God is not the final authority. It's how my neighbor will think. If I open up my house and every Sunday, you know, the cars parked and everything, and we're worshiping God and praising God, what will my neighbors think of me? Will they think I'm crazy? And because of that, you find that a lot of people don't advance to do the will of God. Hallelujah. Their life is governed by what the neighbors will think, by what their brothers will think, by what the co-workers will think. Hallelujah. They'll think, "Oh, I don't fit in. I don't fit in." A lot of people do everything. They die to belong. Hallelujah. Praise God. In the kingdom of God and the kingdom of this world, prosperity comes by what I accumulate and gain. But in the kingdom of God, true prosperity comes by contributing to eternity and the advancement of the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord Jesus.
Amen.
I want to take you through a few Bible characters. I will see the struggles that some of them have, because the truth is that we are not alone. We're not alone in this practice of self-discipline, in this practice of self-denial and giving ourselves wholly to the Lord Jesus. Praise God. And as I said before, one of the problems that we have is that we've got new wines in old wineskins. New wines in old wineskins. And I believe everybody remember the parable of Jesus in Luke chapter 5. If you put a new wine in old wineskins, what will happen? Yep, what will happen?
It'll crack and seep through, yeah.
That's it. It will crack, you will lose the wine, and you will lose the wineskin. Praise God. Why? Because the old wineskin, you see, I don't know if anybody here knows the process of wine making. Anyone? Yeah? Okay. Yeah? You want to tell us a little bit about how they make wine?
They use yeast in their. Basically, they get the grapes.
Yep.
And they squash all the grapes.
Yep.
And then the grape skins are called lees.
Yep.
And they try to remove the lees from the remaining. So they leave it in the vat for a while. They press it all down.
Yep.
And then they add certain sort of artificial type.
Yep.
Flavors.
And actually, got what I was looking for, which is the yeast.
Yes.
Yes. It's the yeast. The yeast that they add to the wine is what makes it to ferment. Praise God. And that's where the grapefruit is just grapefruit. It's sweet. But when they add yeast to it, the fermentation process begins. And they leave it for maybe 2 weeks, 2 months. Some can even leave it for 1 year, 5 years. They leave it to ferment. You see, the old wine skin, because it has gone through that process of fermentation, it's got wine in it, and fermentation has happened. During the fermentation period, that's when the sugar in the grape is actually broken down and it becomes alcohol.
Yeah.
Amen? Yeah. So because this old wineskin has been through that process, it's brittle. It's not strong anymore. Now, if you take new wine that is just fresh, it's not been fermented, because all the chemicals and all the ingredients are still fresh and bubbling, they expand. Amen? They expand. And when they expand, the problem is the old wineskin, because it becomes brittle, cannot handle that expansion. And what happens? It just breaks and it tears. That's why so many Christians are having problems today in their marriages, in everything, because they've got new wine in the old wineskin. They've got this new man, brand new, he's saved and washed by the blood of Jesus, but then he's still inside the old mindset. He still thinks of himself as God. He's not broken down. He's not submissive to the power of God. He's not submitted to anything. He still seems himself as the king. Remember, I said before that the individual is God. You see, you have a new man, brand new, that God has set free, but he's still in this old mindset. At the end of the day, what happens? He finds it difficult. Christianity becomes a struggle. He wakes up in the morning and he just begins to struggle. He does not know, how do I submit myself? He does not know, how do I put myself last and put the kingdom of God first? Hallelujah. At the end of the day, there's a struggle. There's a struggle. Some people are comfortable. So long as I'm a Christian, just leave me alone. I can still keep my cigarette. You know, just leave me alone. So long as I can still keep my beer and my everything. You know, I was in a church meeting, church gathering one time, and one of the guys was telling me, sometimes I do go into the pub, once in a while, go into the pub, I just take a glass of beer and, I just drink and I come out, nothing wrong with that. And I was looking at him, sure, nothing's wrong with that, yeah. It basically shows you've got